Hi, folks. Ryan Honeyman here from Lyft Economy. Many folks have come to us over the last 10 years and asked, how do I get more involved in creating an economy that works for the benefit of all life? They also ask, what skills and experiences do I need to help make this transition? So 3 years ago, we created something called the Next Economy MBA to help address this and similar questions. Lyft Economy's Next Economy MBA is an online course that's designed for entrepreneurs, aspiring entrepreneurs, students, recent graduates, employees, and folks who want to learn more about transformational next economy strategies and businesses. Join the growing alumni network of nearly 250 alumni who've gone through this program and learned essential skills and hopefully built lifelong relationships for catalyzing businesses in the emergent and regenerative economy. So we encourage you to check out our course. You can go to lifteconomy.com/MBA. The next course, Cohort 7, starts on September 21st, 2021. So once again, go to www.lifteconomy.com/MBA. And now, on with the show. Welcome to Next Economy Now. The goal of this podcast series is to highlight the leaders who are taking a regenerative, bioregional, equitable, democratic, racially just, and whole systems approach to creating the new economy.
Natalie, welcome to Next Economy Now.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, great to have you here. And we'd love to get started by just inviting you to share your story and your background and how did you get into the work that you're currently doing?
It's been a journey that I didn't expect. You know, I didn't think that I'd ever be working in business and in one of the largest distributors of organic fruits and vegetables in the U.S. And, you know, my background is I was always kind of a rebellious youth and activist. I guess I was sensitive about what I saw going on in the world around me and felt a desire to protest, to object, to make change. Through that early journey of activism, you know, attending lots of protests and kind of trying to raise social awareness, I got really interested in tipping points and really interested in social movement theory and at what point cultures and societies make significant shifts and changes and what causes that. You know, as a passionate environmentalist, I had felt like we had plenty of environmental science that's telling us that the way we're living as human beings is not going to sustain life on the planet for the long term, from climate change to what we're doing to our depletion of our soils and freshwater resources. But what we really need is a shift in human behavior. And so I went to pursue my doctorate in environmental sociology. You know, how do we take all this natural science that we have and actually change human behavior and society and economy, realize that we need to live more within the limits of nature and still have a good quality of life. In that journey, you know, I'd always kind of felt as an activist that business and corporate behavior was a large part of the problem. I decided to challenge myself to think about how to get into corporations and change corporate behavior. And I was really inspired by what was going on in the organic movement and the sustainability movement and kind of some of the pushes around corporate social responsibility and social entrepreneurs trying to create products and services that could shift behavior and create more adoption of better practices. And so I ended up joining Organically Grown Company as the first sustainability manager. And my job was to take an inventory of a company that had dozens and dozens of trucks on the road, moving millions of pounds of fruits and vegetables every year from farms to retail shelves, and take a full inventory of the footprint of that business and what we could do to start their behavior. Over the course of that, realized that there were the hard changes that we had to make, and there were also the social changes that we had to make. So I ended up over time taking on our human resources function, which I renamed organizational vitality. Do we have vital, are we recruiting and retaining vital people who understand our mission, feel passionate about it, are given great tools, and a workplace that they can contribute their ideas about how we can further our mission and their frontline work. And also I got into advocacy because I realized that we couldn't do our work in a vacuum, that we could do all of the changes within our four walls, within our trucks, to adopt more sustainable practices, be it packaging or energy or our practices, but there was this whole supply chain that we were interacting with. There were all the farmers that we were getting product from, other distributors we were interacting with, the whole trucking infrastructure, as well as the whole policy infrastructure for agriculture in the United States that drives unsustainable practices. And so really needing to get into full system sustainability and think about if we're going to be sustainable, we need to have our partners also change their practices, consumers change their practices, as well as the policy landscape change on things like carbon policy, et cetera. So eventually had sustainability, human resources, and trade advocacy. And I was also on our board of directors. Being on our board of directors, I realized that we could be thinking about principles of regeneration and sustainability in the farming. We could be thinking about bringing those values into the operations. Where we could get pulled off course was our ownership and financing of the business long term, where those also aligned with the principles of regeneration and reinvestment in sustainability, or were those based on more kind of linear models of return? And so really wanted to understand how we could think about bringing those principles into the entire business model, from the products we carry to how we do business, to how we make decisions, and how we own and finance the company and share the economic return over time. And that led me to proposing that we explore restructuring the company ownership. I mean, I also started a trade association.
What's the trade association?
When I was at Organically Grown, I launched the Sustainable Food Trade Association, which eventually now leads, for example, the Climate Collaborative. And it was that notion that we couldn't do sustainability on our own. We had to engage other food businesses in making change as well. So the Sustainable Food Trade Association, we created a declaration of sustainability, kind of my activist spirit. We wrote a declaration of all the ways that the food industry is not sustainable. Even though we were doing organic, we realized that we still had challenges, dependence on fossil fuels and non-renewable packaging, and that we weren't necessarily addressing climate change and emissions or fair labor. And so we put out a declaration to CEOs across the organic and natural sector to sign on to a commitment of improving their practices in 11 areas. They would annually measure and report out on their practices transparently within this community of practice. And we would all move towards long-term sustainability goals together as a community, that we might compete in the marketplace, but there are certain things that we're all challenged with that we'll all get there faster if we share best practices and report and look for shared initiatives across our industry to make change and catalyze change. We get quicker adoption. And also that kind of healthy competition drives innovation. That organization still exists, and I'm an emeritus on the board, and there's over 100 businesses and, you know, probably over $5 billion worth of companies in that association now.
Wonderful. So have you seen the standards increase as a result of it, or what's been?
Oh, yeah. The Sustainable Food Trade Association, many of those businesses are now becoming certified B Corps. Many of them are some of the leaders in sustainability practices with regards to regenerative organic agriculture and climate change mitigation, the whole Climate Collaborative initiative, and signing up for commitments and changing practices. But again, it ties back to ownership, because one of the things that I found is that in the organic sector, we have these founders who are very passionate about transforming food and agriculture through their products and services, and that's where they got into it. And then they end up running healthy, profitable businesses, but over time, they need to figure out who's going to own and sustain the business over time. And we've seen a lot of consolidation and investment in the organic sector, because it's a hot sector to be involved in, by people who don't necessarily understand that these businesses were built primarily with this ethos of transforming food and agriculture, which meant that their founders were plowing the resources and the revenues back into that mission. And instead, new owners kind of take decision-making further and further away from the people who are close to delivering on that mission every day. And so they can start to cut corners, cut practices. Maybe we don't need to invest in that sustainability initiative or that fair trade initiative. And my concern is that over time, unless you really keep the structures that keep these businesses with their missions locked in, they can erode over time as new owners take the helm with more of a conventional paradigm.
And I want to go more into that, but I also want to just, you know, reflect on and appreciate your background, you know, coming from an activist and becoming an academic and then a business leader, right? As a strategic lever for change. Definitely resonate and appreciate that approach, right? Very, very, very proactive and engaged and strategic.
Thank you. Well, now I find myself talking, kind of going upstream to talk about the way businesses are structured and organized from a governance and economic return perspective, because that drives so much of corporate behavior. So now I'm talking upstream to investors and owners about how the structures that they've chosen and the terms that they've chosen are driving behaviors lower down in the organization. So if we want businesses to behave in a more regenerative, sustainable way, we need to really unpack and look at how we're structuring decision-making and return expectations and where the returns are going over time, and look at retooling those paradigms in order to have a deeper impact. So that's my new journey is, you know, now I find I'm talking to investor conferences and entrepreneurs and founders about these structural issues and term sheets and financial modeling.
So if I could ask you, could you contrast a business as usual model versus what you've been pioneering with employee-owned trust?
And I'll clarify, it's actually a purpose-owned trust, and I can get into that. So comparing and contrasting, I'd say the dominant form of ownership that corporations have been moving towards in the last 50 years has been shareholder capitalism. Shareholder capitalism has really led to a lot more extraction in the economy, which means that tremendous wealth is being created, but that wealth tends to be more and more concentrated into those people who own shares and capital. And it is also leading to a lot of distance between those people who are actually creating the products and services delivery and making the decisions in businesses every day through their work, and the investors who can be very far from how their investments are being made. So in shareholder capitalism, oftentimes you're looking at an abstract figure around what is your rate of return, and the goal is for you to maximize your rate of return, but you might be very detached from how that return is being made and what are the behaviors that are being mandated in the enterprise itself in order to generate those returns. And that's where we've seen suppression of wages over time. We've seen irresponsible behaviors in terms of environmental practices, thinking about short-term quarterly gains versus long-term sustainability of the resources in which we all depend, thinking about corporate responsibility to the communities in which businesses operate. Oftentimes, as companies get bigger and there's more consolidation and globalization, we see kind of movement of businesses to uproot from their communities that they've been embedded and grown in, that have been a part of their success, towards moving to where labor is cheapest, where regulations are the most lax in order to maximize profit. So there's really a core issue here, which is this notion that the purpose of the corporation is to make money as the driver of the purpose of the corporation. And what we're trying to get back to and promote is the notion that the purpose of the corporation is to serve society and to create products and services that are of value to communities, whether it's healthcare, whether it's good information through media, whether it's healthy, nourishing food that tastes good, that people can access affordably, that doesn't erode our soil and our climate. So we want to use the engine of enterprise, because enterprise, there's drivers around innovation, and private enterprise can be a tremendous force for delivering value. However, the primary driver should be delivering that value. The secondary result is you do create a profit, but it's a means to an end, not an end in itself. And so what we're talking about is really shifting what the ends of the corporation are away from a focus on just driving stockholder value as the primary driver to driving actual value through products and services. And as a byproduct, having a return, and a return to capital is the importance of resources to grow your business, but it's one of the outcomes amongst other outcomes that your business creates.
So how does this lead us to the perpetual purpose trust as a solution?
Sure. Let me speak to the organically grown company story. Organically Grown Company is one of the largest independent distributors of organic fruits and vegetables in the U.S. And why the business exists was it was founded to transform food and agriculture through its products and services. And the original impetus was to help build and grow the market for organic agriculture. And at the time, the company was founded in 1978, there was really no infrastructure for organic. When our farmers went to get agronomic services from extension agents, they told them that they couldn't help. And organic really wasn't quite recognized in the marketplace yet. So the origination of the business was as a nonprofit to help farmers in our region learn how to grow organically, to give them access to research and materials, as well as to educate the public. But quickly realized that the best way to transform food and agriculture would be to help the farmers make a living doing it by that they could farm differently and that we could actually get products to shelves in our regions that people could access, that were good quality, that were affordable. So we switched from a nonprofit to a for-profit to pursue that mission of transforming food and agriculture. The way the business had always operated was to reinvest the bulk of the income back into furthering its growth of mission. So be that reinvesting in some of the profits in a new packing line that could expand our ability to help smaller farmers access markets by aggregating their product and packing it out together, or reinvesting in some of the nonprofits and trade associations that were growing the organic marketplace, or investing in bringing on more employees to move the product and to make sure we were paying them wages that could sustain their livelihoods and grow the market. So we'd always operate in this way of mission first as the reason why we exist, reinvesting the income of the company back into that mission and the people who were carrying out that mission over time. And one of the problems that we ran up against as the business grew is that it grew in value. So we have over 250 employees. We're moving over 100 million pounds of fruits and vegetables every year. And a question that some of our founders were asking is, who's going to own the company over time to make sure that we continue to operate with this service orientation and this mission orientation? Who are going to be the next generation of people who will hold the control of the business to make sure that we continue to direct our decisions in this way? And also, how are we going to attract investment into the company to grow and expand our mission? Because we do need capital to expand the mission in a way that would be non-extractive, pulling a lot of that value that we want to invest back into the business. And so we were particularly concerned that as the company grew, it could also create some tension with those who hold the company ownership being tempted to cash in, as many companies, you know, they scale, they become attractive to buyers. And we were looking for a new owner that would reinvest the bulk of the profits back into the company as we had done, as well as continue to treat the company not as a commodity to be sold to the highest bidder, but an engine for carrying out our mission, where control should be held in those by those who are close to the mission, and returns should be primarily reinvested and shared with those who are close to the mission. So we needed a solution for our founders retiring. We needed a solution for bringing in outside capital for growth and succession. I'll just say in 40 years, we'd always bootstrapped the business. We'd never taken on outside investment. We were afraid of giving control away and having outside investment be predicated on the eventual sale of the business, which we didn't want to do. We wanted to stay independent. And so I was on the board saying, isn't there a way that we could bring in an investment, but on terms that wouldn't be extractive, but that could actually help propel our mission, and we could give it a reasonable balanced return on balance with returns to other stakeholders? So that's what we were up against. And we decided to shift. We'd been a nonprofit. We'd been an agricultural marketing co-op. We'd added on an employee stock ownership plan. And we decided to restructure our ownership to form a trust and to have the trust buy the shares back from the company. And what's unique about the trust that we established is it's called a purpose trust. And what that means is there are no human beneficiaries of the assets in that trust. The direct beneficiary of the assets in that trust is the purpose. So no individual can claim personal property rights over the assets in the trust, which is all of the company common stock. Rather, the trust directs the trustees to use 100% of the assets that are held in the trust, which is all of the company stock, to deliver results to the purpose for which the trust was established. And so we made the beneficiary the purpose, and the purpose is to promote sustainable food and agriculture with the assets in the trust. So we've transferred 100% of the company ownership into the trust. The trust, unlike a person who would be an owner, will never die and never needs to extract income from it. So it's almost like we've designed this benevolent owner that will never die, never needs a return, and directs the company board and management to run a great company that delivers to the purpose and reinvest the income that the company makes over time back into the business and to share with the stakeholders who are creating the value as we go. And in our trust, we have 5 stakeholder groups that share in the returns of the company. There are employees, our farmers, our customers, our community allies, which are the nonprofits and trade associations, which provide the landscape in which we operate, and we feel they're critical to our success, and investors. So all 5 of those groups share in the return, but none of them has the private property right to sell the company over time. And they all share in the economic returns as well as the governance on balance. But the company is no longer a commodity that could be bought and sold at someone's whim. And the company is essentially held in trust for that long-term purpose and stewardship of that purpose.
Curious of, you know, what were your reference points for even having the idea, and what kind of did you face? Because I can imagine talking to, you know, a normal lawyer and them saying, you want to do what? No, you can't do that.
Yeah.
And well, there'd be a decent amount of pushback on some of these more altruistic ideas.
Sure. Well, certainly some of the lawyers that we spoke to and people who had been on our board that had been on multiple corporate boards, they said, you know, typically, you know, shares are held by those who invest the most money, and those who invest the most money have the most governance power. And the way that you are rewarded as a shareholder is to eventually sell the business or to sell your stake in the business. And that's the dominant paradigm, is to drive profitability, drive share value, and get out while the price is high. So this notion that we're going to have an owner that would exist in perpetuity and never die and never sell the company, that really flips that paradigm on its head. So talking to lawyers to try to find a solution, we worked with a great law firm called Stoll Reeves and an attorney who has a long history in the cooperative movement. And so when we first brought this idea to him that, you know, we'd been employee and farmer owned, but we were concerned about acquisition over time. We were concerned about how we'd continue to pass the business on to maintain the purpose into future generations, so it maintained itself as this enterprise for doing its mission into perpetuity. We sent him some articles. We got turned on by the National Center for Employee Ownership onto an alternative to ESOP called Employee Ownership Trusts. And there's a young lawyer named Christopher Michael based on the East Coast. And he's been promoting employee ownership trusts as an alternative to employee stock ownership plans. And essentially, it simplifies employee ownership in that founders sell their companies into a trust. The trust holds all the shares into perpetuity to never sell the company. And the employees hold the governance rights to elect the board, run the company, and they simply share in the profits as they go. A very prominent example of this is John Lewis Partnerships, which is in England, which is a chain of department stores. But there are emerging examples in the United States, Metis Construction, Equity Atlas, and others. And so it's essentially a very simplified ESOP that rather than the employees stepping in as shareholders to take on shareholding, be allocated shares, be bought back when they leave the company, those shares get bought back and recycled to the next employees. You simplify it by not dealing with stockholding. The stock is all held by the trust. Since it will never exit, none of the company money needs to be used for stock buyback. And 100% of the company money can then be used to reinvest in the business and simply do annual profit sharing with the employees as you go. So it's still sharing 100% of the economic benefit with employees and the governance employees without the complication of stock buybacks, transfers, valuation, and so forth. So we took that model and we said, well, our purpose is beyond just holding the company for the benefit of employees. Our purpose is holding the company for the benefit of transforming food and agriculture through continuing to innovate our products and services in the marketplace so that we can help farmers farm more sustainably and we can help consumers access more sustainable products and we can create a living for people doing the work along the way. So it's really a multi-stakeholder purpose and the purpose is really transforming food and agriculture and in the process benefiting the people who are doing the work of transforming food and agriculture. So we basically modified the employee ownership trust concept by making it multi-stakeholder, as well as really anchoring it on this social and environmental purpose beyond any one group of individuals, but benefiting individuals who are participating in that purpose.
I actually know Chris Michael here in New York, and I actually worked on setting up a cooperative as a trust with him. And yeah, I was really struck by the kind of the elegant simplicity of that model. But yeah, thanks for sharing how you kind of, you know, ran with that concept and took it multi-stakeholder and perpetual purpose. That's really beautiful.
Yeah, we're anchoring it in the purpose of the company is to be a transformative force. And over time, we'll evolve our products and services to continue to make that transformation. So we're doing organic. Over time, we added on fair trade. Over time, we've added on other environmental and sustainability standards and operations. So, you know, over time, we might iterate on our products and services, but that end goal, that North Star of the purpose, stays embedded in the trust and why we exist and how we're owned and who we exist to serve. And that's very clear over time, and that won't change. What will change is who's participating, right? We could have employees come and go. We could have farmers come and go. We could have customers come and go. But while they're participating, they're sharing in that governance of the stewardship of the purpose, as well as the returns as we go. So it actually incents everyone to work towards that shared purpose. And as we're successful, share in that return. So it's a deep incentivization of the purpose all the way through the structure into your supply chain and your workforce and even your customer base. And that's what I think is, you know, a big paradigm shift is a lot of corporations say that they're working on corporate social responsibility and that they care about the triple bottom line. But if you look at who has the power and where the money goes, most of the decisions are being made by those who hold the economic rights, which are a single group of people. That's also who at the end of the day holds the value and the ability to sell the value of the company at any time or extract dividends and profits. So in our model, we're retooling that. We're saying capital is a really important and investment's a really important part of growing your business, but it's one seat in the boat amongst the other seats in the boat being filled by your other constituents who are also important to making the engine go. It's your workers who are bringing their labor and creativity every day, your suppliers who are bringing their product to you and their work in the field, your customers who are bringing their loyalty and their choosing to direct their purchases to you, the communities in which you operate that gain and support you, and your investors who are providing capital. So we're all kind of rowing this the engine of this boat forward, and none of us has the right to claim ownership of the underlying enterprise, but we can all share as we work together in a portion of the return and in the governance.
How's it working out? Like, can you share a success, share a failure or a challenge or a key learning that's kind of coming out of your journey here?
Yeah, so we established the trust in 2017, and our first thing that we had to do was offer to buy back shares from our existing farmer and employee shareholders to move the shares into the trust. So we did that initial repurchase through a partnership of a loan with RSF Social Finance, and then we did something that an idea that we borrowed from some of our co-op friends, like Equal Exchange and Organic Valley. We did a non-voting preferred stock offering that investors could participate and essentially get a coupon type return that would allow our company the capital to buy back some stock. And we could pay back investors at a rate of return that was on par with our ability to reinvest in the business and share with other stakeholders. And they didn't hold the right to drive the share value of the company and sell it. So essentially, you invest and you get kind of a baseline dividend and then a portion of the profit sharing amongst the other stakeholders. So our board was quite hesitant about our ability to raise non-voting preferred stock. We'd never gone and raised outside capital in our 40 years. And we thought, as a wholesale distributor, we were kind of in the background. We weren't quite sure who would invest in this. And we were really excited about the fact that we had planned to do the offering for up to 4 years, and we closed the offering in 18 months. And the reason is we found that there's a real appetite. We had some great lead investors participate who were funds like Purpose Evergreen Capital and Candide Group and Natural Investing, as well as regional foundations participated. We had Oregon Community Foundation, the debt, the Russell Family Foundation and the Puget Sound, as well as lots of individuals who came knocking when they heard that we had preferred stock to offer farmers that we'd worked with over the years, employees, customers in the community who had been purchasing organic fruits and vegetables at some of the stores that we sell to for years and realized our role in providing the infrastructure and wanted to invest in our mission and what we were doing. And what we found was, at first, we had some trepidation that investors wouldn't like this deal, that they didn't have control of the company, and that they were simply getting a share of a portion of the profits over time, but this wasn't about driving the value of the business to sell the stock at a higher value later on. But in fact, investors got it, and they understood the kind of different terms that we were putting forward and the fact that those terms would allow us to share with other stakeholders and also keep our independence and mission intact. So we were excited that our raise closed ahead of time, and we were able to recapitalize the stock into the trust. And we're really excited about the level of support that we got from individuals, foundations, funds. And I really think that there's a shift going on right now where people realize that there's a problem with shareholder capitalism through stock markets where it's so distant. And they're wanting to invest in companies in their backyard that are creating real infrastructure and real results towards the sustainable food economy. And they're willing to take different investment terms because they understand it's not just changing the what they're investing in, but the how, and that changing their mindset about how they're investing and thinking about companies that create multi-stakeholder return actually generates deeper impact with their investment and a more sustainable return for them over time. So we're really excited about our stock raise and how that went. The other thing that was really fun was our first annual meeting this year. You know, typically we'd have shareholder meetings in the past where those who held shares showed up and we'd do the financial results and vote for the board, and that was the annual meeting. This year, since we're owned by the trust, we invited all of our qualified stakeholders, so our 5 stakeholder groups, to participate in our annual meeting. And the trustees were giving a report to all of our stakeholders, so our employees, our farmers, our community, our investors, and all of them got to vote for the trustees, as well as weigh in on some things that the trustees were looking for advice on in terms of how we would reinvest the profits this year, and what kinds of services and community benefits, as well as what metrics we would use to measure results to the purpose. So a real shift in what the shareholder meeting looked like towards kind of that multi-stakeholder model, and really a lot of transparency and co-participation and stewarding the company by people who are bringing different things to the table.
So how many people were in the room?
A few hundred. Wow. We had to have it in a barn. Luckily, it was a nice sunny day. And we even had people like one of our congressional reps, Earl Blumenauer, show up, because I think people are really turned on to this idea that we're going to need new economic paradigms if we want outcomes to shift, and if we want corporate behavior to shift, and if we want corporations to create broader wealth for communities, we need to think about doing governance and doing economic returns and structures differently. And so there was a lot of buzz around even our representative showing up to support a new endeavor, which was cool.
That's great. So anything on the challenge or failure or learning side that share others that might follow your lead here?
Yeah, well, certainly our journey to get into the trust structure took a lot of legal research and time to figure out what trust law to use, how to structure the corporation, how to do the investment offering, how to set up the governance, and really the conversion from our ESOP S-Corp into a purpose trust took about 3 years in total. So one of the things that we're trying to do now through our work with the Purpose Foundation, the nonprofit, as well as this Alternative Ownership Advisors consultancy that Organically Grown Company has started, is to try to make it faster and easier for other entrepreneurs and founders to head this direction. So we're trying to create open source toolkits, publications, case studies, materials, networks of lawyers and legal professionals who understand these alternative stewardship ownership corporate forms, as well as alternative investment paradigms, so that you have someone to call who won't look at you cross-eyed when you tell them that you want to transition to a stewardship ownership model. And we'll actually have more tools and templates and resources at people's fingertips. Because that was certainly a challenge for us, was trying to design something from scratch. It was expensive and time consuming.
Well, tell us more about the Purpose Foundation.
Yeah, so the Purpose Network and Foundation was founded in Europe, and now there's a branch out of the Bay Area partnered with RSF Social Finance, and Organically Grown supported its launch last year. The goal is to make stewardship ownership the dominant form of ownership into the next century. So how do we shift from kind of absentee shareholder capitalism, that's a more extractive model, or stewardship-based models, which are about focusing the purpose of the corporation on its purpose and holding it in stewardship for that purpose, making sure the steering wheel and the control stays with the people who are close to that purpose. So it's really about companies being self-determined and companies reinvesting the bulk of their profits back into that purpose and sharing with those who are creating the value towards. So the Purpose Foundation is working on research and education, infrastructure development around these models, hands-on support, and network building amongst founders and entrepreneurs and investors who are interested in exploring these models and adopting these models, as well as there's a Purpose Evergreen Capital, which is a fund that helps companies who are transitioning into these models with some of the recapitalization they might have to do to get their business into a stewardship model. And then I'm working additionally with Organically Grown Company. We started an offshoot to help peer companies on their journey towards alternative ownership, where we're going to take our knowledge and our network that we developed around Purpose Trust and kind of be hands-on with peer founders to think through their ownership and governance design, as well as if they want to bring on investment capital or they need liquidity, how to do that in a way that is aligned with these principles of stewardship and, you know, sharing the value. There is a lot of buzz going right now on stewardship ownership models as an alternative. I think there are a lot of mission-driven social entrepreneurs who are mature enough in their businesses that they're looking for liquidity, and they also want to protect that legacy of that social enterprise that they've started. So we're working quite a bit with companies in the organic and natural food space, healthcare, media, tech, entrepreneurs who are passionate about their companies and kind of the baby that they've stewarded on that social mission, and looking for structures that they can pass their legacy into that will sustain that mission and lasting independence. There are dozens of companies that we are working with across the Purpose Network to explore these models right now in multiple sectors. And we're also starting to see younger entrepreneurs who are starting companies thinking about setting them up in stewardship from the beginning, which I also think is really exciting. You know, thinking from the get-go about how to be multi-stakeholder in their governance and in their sharing of returns, thinking about how they bring on early stage investment, where the goal is to grow the company, but to not sell control over time and to not take that company away from mission. So there are dozens of companies that I predict that will be coming online with steward ownership models in the next couple of years. And I'm hoping there'll be some real lighthouses across sectors that will then kind of snowball other entrepreneurs in these sectors to consider these models.
You know, and I'm also impressed that it's maybe about 40 minutes into the conversation, we haven't even mentioned that there's a national emergency and a global pandemic that's spreading now. How do you see this impacting this steward ownership model, even now and going forward?
Sure. Well, I mean, I think everyone's focus right now is on the basics of making sure that we have our health and our families are safe, and that we're getting critical infrastructure done. So I know at our company, Organically Grown Company, right now, the focus is on making sure we continue to feed people and get healthy organic food on people's shelves, that they're stocked, and that our workers are safe and taken care of in the process of providing that critical infrastructure. But as I kind of step back and think about some of the turmoil that we're going through right now. You know, one of the key anxieties, loss of income as a result of economic disturbance. And it really demonstrates the fragility of our economic system, that so many people are living on the edge. You know, personally, I think about these numbers of people who don't have enough savings to be able to pay the rent or pay basic bills or even go grocery shopping without that last paycheck. And I think that points to this bigger macroeconomic problem that I think stewardship ownership models can help address, which is looking at how we share the economic value that's being created in society with a broader group of stakeholders. I think we've created tremendous wealth and value in the last century, but it hasn't been distributed. In fact, it's gotten more and more concentrated. And I think with stewardship models, you can change the paradigm of where the value that's being created goes, and you can change the focus away from the purpose of the corporation is to just generate value for shareholders to the purpose of the corporation is to generate value that is spread across communities, be it the customers that the corporation serves, the suppliers that the corporation works with, the employees that are employed. How do we try to pay the best wages and benefits that we can to our workers? How do we try to pay the best prices to the farmers that are supplying us so that they can make a living? How do we provide the most affordable, accessible products to our customers? We can actually take the economics that the companies are generating and reinvest in those constituencies rather than just taking the bulk of the return to reward to shareholders. And I think that that spreading of the value across the value chain can be one of the ways that we're retooling our economy to address some of these deep systemic issues that come up in crises like this as real problems for everyday people.
So deep integrated solution. And hopefully, I mean, so do you predict you're going to get more people interested in this model?
Yeah, I think, you know, the other thing that we're seeing right now is the shocks in the stock market. And we know that that kind of boom and bust cycling of the stock market also causes a lot of anxiety and hardship. And I think that there's going to be a shift towards people looking at investing in brands and products and services more locally, and that have more stability and accountability and transparency, that they're in their backyard, products and services and companies that they believe in that are creating real value. And so I think that there will be a shift over time in people divesting from the stock market and looking for real assets and real value that's being created in local economies with values-driven products and services. And I think these stewardship models will prove to be more stable in the returns that they create over time because they're not an extractive boom and bust model. They're a very kind of sustainable long-term thinking model that creates shared incentives across those in the value chain. So I'm thinking that there's going to be change in investor behavior as well as change in company behavior over time to find models that are more stable and sustainable over time. And I think part of that is looking at, you know, the corporate form itself and retooling that.
I mean, I just really appreciate you, you know, modeling solutions at this moment where they're so needed, right?
Yeah. So, I mean, I think a lot of people are just focused on kind of crisis management right now. So it's when people come out of crisis management and are thinking about redesign for solutions that don't have some of these structural flaws. And I'm hoping that, you know, we turn a more progressive direction after this crisis as a result of some of what it reveals.
Absolutely. Curious, is there anything you need right now that our listeners might be able to provide some support for?
I think that the challenges that we're facing as a society with the environment as well as social inequality require bold thinking and redesign of some of our fundamental paradigms. And I think we as social entrepreneurs and investors need to really unpack where the existing tools and forms aren't serving us and to be brave and to be bold about trying something new, even though lawyers or investors or others might say, well, that's not the way it's done. Now's the time. Now's the time to be bold and ask questions about why it's been done that way. And the new ideas about where we need to go will come from us as long as we're bold in asking questions. So I guess my appeal to others is be bold and ask these questions about why we've done it this way, and let's go forth with redesigning the new paradigm, because there's no time to lose.
You're here. Well, thank you so much, Natalie. Really appreciate you joining us today, and really appreciate the important work that you're modeling for everybody.
Well, thank you for having me. It's been a great conversation.
Next Economy Now is a production of Lyft Economy. To listen to all of our episodes, go to lifteconomy.com/podcast. That's lifteconomy.com/podcast. You can also sign up for our monthly newsletter at lifteconomy.com/newsletter. Please also rate and review our podcast on iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.